I should perhaps first say what interests me still today very much, that it was possible to keep so outspoken personalities as these painters and sculptors in the Bauhaus together. In spite of their very strong individual personalities, which gave very often arguments in the whole Bauhaus, they all believed in the basic idea and stuck to it. Klee definitely did also so. There's quite a lot of his writings which gives very clear evidence of it. Klee took it very seriously. He didn't thought before he came to the Bauhaus. One has now found about 4,000 sheets as preparatory work for his courses he gave in the Bauhaus. He went very deep with that. And he was fascinating for all the students who went to his course. Every one of these personalities, Kandinsky, Schlemmer, Mohle, Klee, Albers, they had a completely different approach to these things. And I thought, when you take somebody in as a teacher, as a member of the faculty, you can say either a complete yes to him and then let him go and develop what he wants to do. You cannot interfere. When it doesn't work, you have to say no and get rid of him. This didn't happen. The only clash which ever happened there was with Johannes Itten, who was an extraordinary teacher, who really laid the basic courses for the Bauhaus. But he mixed it up so very much with Masdas Nan, for instance, and other things which did not have directly to do with the Bauhaus. And he was against my idea to build up the student with a real good crafts education, that there was a clash between us and he withdrew, which I was sorry about because he was a strong personality and gave very much to it. But this idea of the four course as he built it up, the preliminary course for everyone who had to go through there for a half year or a full year, was taken up by Josef Albers and by Mohle Nagy and also by the others in courses to prepare the young artist to know first about the whole problem of art and design before he was too much fixed. The main thing in the foreground for all of us was to destroy imitation. The young man, of course, is inclined to imitate his master, but we tried to discourage that very much. At least when he did so, he was told, that's not you, that is your teacher, so that he really knew it. There was quite some crisis with some of the students on account of that. But this was the way to build up the individual on himself. We tried to develop, so to speak, a science of design. All objective things out of the physiological and psychological life of men, which are objectively true for you and me and everyone else, these we tried to collect and bring together and make articulate, and that was what we taught the students. But he had to build up himself out of this understanding and knowledge. The only one of them I knew well was Gerhard Marx, the sculptor. I was a very close friend of his brother, and I saw him many years before the Bauhaus started. So he was the only one I knew. All the others I did not know before. When the idea came up and the possibility to make a new appointment, I went a long way to really know something about the personality, except perhaps with Kandinsky, who was in Russia, and I had to rely on what I heard about him and saw of his paintings. You know, in Berlin was the exhibition Der Sturm by Herbert Walden, which was rather well known. And all of these artists had exhibitions there, and I went there regularly in order to keep myself up to date on what was happening in art. Finding I was very much in seclusion. He was always somewhat withdrawn, but he was a wonderful human being and had a very strong charisma. He was really felt by everybody. The very fact that he was present there, that he has his studio in the Bauhaus all the time, was very influential on many students, and he had an open door for those students who wanted to come and have his advice and have his criticism on the work the student did, but he did not give any courses. And also when we went over from Weimar to Dessau, We took him with us, and he got his house and studio, because we all felt that his presence was so important. But he never gave any direct courses. Molinari was an extremely lively personality. He was almost childlike in his interest that everything new which came up in techniques and so on electrified him. He went right after that. He was an experimental fellow. He tried everything out himself. He was perhaps the closest friend of mine in the Bauhaus, and we influenced each other quite a bit. Molinari was understanding what was going on in the economy and the industrial life of the modern time, and tried to build his ideas into that. He touched many, many different problems in art. When he died much too early in 1946, I think, I went to the Museum of Modern Art in New York and said, this is a case where you could really make an exhibition to show in many faces of one personality how wide this range can be. Nothing happened, because I think the jealousy of the department chiefs and the museums don't want to mix up these things. But this was just the idea of the Bauhaus, to mix up these things, to see that there is no real barrier of any real meaning between a painting or the other things of our environment. How very much intertwined everything is, what came out of such a laboratory test in the Bauhaus went really from the daily pieces to a painting or to a layout for a part of a city. It is all the same approach as to the problem of effect on the human being, of light, color, space, form. There's no barrier between the different fields. Only the interpretation and the aim of use is a different one. When you make a painting, this is of course an emotional affair which has an effect on human beings. When you make a chair, it's a very practical thing which has use value, but beyond that also, it should be beautiful. I consider beauty a basic requirement of life, which is not recognized sufficiently today.